Hello, everyone. So now we come to the crux of the discussion about Thales, right? Now, we have talked about Arche, which is the sort of, you know, origin of all things, which is the unity of all things, which, you know, takes you from the beginning to the end in that sense. And what Thales sort of is said to have said is that water was Arche, yeah? And this came, as we discussed in the previous video, from this impulse to generalize, to discard the individual and the accidental, and to bring out the universal and the permanent, right? So this impulse to sort of, you know, move from like personalized explanations to go towards an abstract and universal explanation. So what is an arche? An arche, it's a word used by Aristotle, and I'll read out the section from Aristotle, is the first principle of all things, as he explains it, right? Which means that it is the starting point or the beginning of things. It's also the originating cause of things. And, you know, that goes sort of from like, that starts and then infuses the you know, becoming of things, as Aristotle would understand it. So I'll read out a section from Aristotle's Metaphysics Alpha. So this is the text, if you're interested. Where he talks about Thales, yeah? So I'll read this out. Well, of the first philosophers, the majority thought that the causes in the form of nature, in the form of matter, were alone the principles of all things. For that from which all entities come, from which each thing primarily arises, and into which it is at the end resolved, the substance remaining, but changing as to affections, this they announced to be the element and principle of all entities. And for this reason, they thought that nothing either came to be or was destroyed, since this sort of nature was always preserved. Right? And I'll continue, but think of this. What's going on here is that he's talking about, you know, the first philosophers who thought of, you know, the arche, the first principle of all things, as being something material. That's what Aristotle is saying. And this arche is something that, you know, from which everything begins, but it's also into which everything is resolved, which means that the substance, you know, the hypokaimenon, the substance remains, but its affections, its appearances change. And this, they said, was the principle and entity of all things. And this is something that is preserved, right? This sort of nature was always preserved. And I'll continue reading. So that we do not even say that Socrates either came into being simpliciter when he became fine or musical, nor that he was destroyed when he lost these dispositions, since the substrate remained, right? So for about one single person, in this case Socrates, you know, if he became musical, he learned music, let's say, then is he not Socrates anymore? He's still Socrates, right? So Socrates remains, even though there is something in Socrates that changes, which means the substance remains, Socrates, the matter remains, but what changes is his something in his form, like the musicality, you know, so he becomes a musical sort of person. Socrates himself, this is what remains, right? That's a substrate. And the same consideration they thought applied to all other things, right? And not just with people like Socrates, but with everything, you'd have the substance that remains and the affections would change. For they thought that there must be some nature, either one or more than one, and we're looking at both cases, from which other things arose while it was conserved, right? So there is some nature, some pousis, some matter, you know, which could be just a single matter, like with Thales attributed, you know, this matter is supposed to be water, or more than one, you know, which remains, which is conserved while other things change. But the number and form of such a principle, they do not at all proclaim to be the same. Yeah. So some say there is one, some say there is more. Thales, the introducer of this sort of philosophy, said that it was water, and this is our source for this claim. That is why he declared the earth to be sitting on water, right? So the idea that, you know, the earth floats on water. And it's something that we can also sort of then connect to the Okeanos in Homer, but we can talk about it, yeah? So perhaps drawing the supposition from seeing that the nourishment of all creatures is moist, and the warmth itself arises from this, and that it is by this that all creatures live. So the explanation that Aristotle has given is not, you know, Okeanos or whatever. The explanation he gives is that the nourishment of all things is moist, right? So it's a natural explanation. It's an explanation of even the idea via nature. So why water? Because, you know, the nourishment of all creatures is water. And warmth arises from this, and it is by this that all creatures live. And the assumption from which a thing comes is its principle in all cases. And this is another thing, that, you know, the assumption that if water nourishes all things, then everything must come from water. Yeah? For this reason, indeed, taking this assumption, and also because the seeds of all creatures have a moist nature, and water is the natural principle for moist things, right? So this assumption that, you know, this is the generator, the seed of all things is moist, right? So the idea that, you know, everything comes from water also comes from this very sort of physics, biology kind of an idea of the generation of things from the moist. And there are also some who think that the very ancient thinkers and those long before the present generation and the first to reason about the gods made the same assumptions about nature. For these poets, and we are talking now about poets, made ocean and Tethys the parents of creation and said that the oath of the gods was water, which was called Styx, right? So the ancient poets would take an oath to Styx, the river. And we talked about Okeanos and Tethys already, so I'm not going to sort of dwell on that too much. For the assumption was that the most ancient thing was the most worthy, and that an oath was the most worthy thing. And this is something that, you know, you see even now, but like the idea that, you know, the what is most ancient? Let's find the most ancient thing. The most ancient is, Aristotle says, for ancient poets, it is Styx, right? And if it is Styx, then let's pray to Styx. If then this opinion that nature happens to be primordial and ancient is perhaps unclear, yet Thales is said to have made these declarations concerning the primary cause. For Hippo, one would not think right to include with these thinkers because of the triviality of his mind. Okay, sorry, skip that last sentence. But Thales was said to have made these declarations concerning the primary cause. So this is, you know, an extract, and there's a one more, I think. But this is an extract from Aristotle where he talks about Thales. Now, what can we derive from this? One, that all things were once water, is what he's saying. If we apply it to Thales, all things are still water, despite the changes, you know, that you see in its appearance. So, you know, you see water as something that is solid, you see water as something that is gaseous, or you know, if all things are water, then, you know, like this sort of cloth is water, grass is water, tree is water, metal is water, you know, like it takes a stretch of imagination to really see what Thales was seeing. So, all things are still water despite the changes. At core, you know, and at its base, it's still water. And this is a sort of modern thinking, you know, if you think about it, what we observe around us, you know, it's not something that, you know, can be observed. What we observe around us, you know, we see all these sort of things material, and to imagine that everything is made of like quarks and electrons and protons or I don't know what. So it's not something that we observe like immediately in our everyday life. So in the same way, at this time, you know, they didn't even have all these sort of machines and instruments to check if, you know, whatever they said made sense or not. So what they're going on about and what Thales is going on about with water is actually very interesting for this reason, because from observation, let's say, that the one that Aristotle claims, he says that, you know, that the nourishment of all creatures is moist, that warmth is generated from moisture, you know, and you know, all of these things. This mere observation nevertheless led them to make a leap of imagination. I think that's all it can be called, a leap of imagination, that everything is constituted of water, and at core, everything is water, right? So now let us really think about the relevance of water. Why water? You know, there are like a lot of other things that he could have chosen. if you look at the world, there are many other options. And in fact, we'll see with later philosophers that they do come up with other primary sort of, you know, matter, other primary elements. But what is so relevant, I mean, what is so special about water is that it explains not only matter, like think about it, it's sort of something that one has seen transformation of. It can turn into ice, right? It turns into snow and ice, and you can see the material changes to it. And it can evaporate, turn into water, it can turn into mist, into air, into mist, you know, all these different things. Perhaps even, you know, I don't know, probably not fire. I highly doubt it. But you can see the transformation. And but you know, like the water that evaporates at 100 degrees Celsius is hot. So the idea is, well, fire is hot, this is hot, there must be some similarity. And then, you know, you could make a leap of imagination and think that, you know, perhaps at very sort of at some point it will become fire. Anyway, we are attributing too much to this, and we'll come to Anaximenes and see how he does actually use this kind of an explanation for what he calls, you know, the primary matter, which is air for him. But water is something that, you know, transforms, changes, goes through transformations in a predictable manner. It moves. Very importantly, and especially think about somebody living on, you know, the seashore in Miletus, in western part of Ionia. The sea is constantly moving; it never stops. You know, if you have observed the sea, you would notice that there is no stillness in sea. Rivers as well, no stillness. In fact, even lakes are not really still water. That water seems to constantly move. And we know that there are other reasons, it's like, you know, for its movement. But what they would have observed is that water is constantly moving. And inasmuch as it can move, or inasmuch as it moves, it can be cause of movement, it can be cause of change, and that means that you don't need a second cause of movement, you know. So these philosophers had this tendency to try and, you know, apply Occam's razor in that sense, that, you know, to find like one thing that could explain everything, if possible. So water by itself could explain movement and change, and you did not need to add a second thing, that this is the thing that moves water. Right, and that's why these philosophers, and Thales particularly, is called a monist philosopher, because there's only, you know, just, this is a monist philosophy. There's just one element that explains everything, from like the constitution of things, the beginning of things, the end of things, the movement of things, the change of things, like everything, all alterations, all change, everything is explained via this one substance. So the idea that water has this inherent mobility, like air, we'll see later, fire, you know, some people choose that as well. And so it can be the material of change, it is the material of change, but it can also be the author of change, the generator of change, yeah? And a monist philosophy, you know, has this tendency of wishing for, well, that is what a monist philosophy is, that the world is made of one substance, you know. It could also be made of one idea, we'll see later, let's say that's a different issue, but it's made of one substance. And to be the arche, this one substance, this one primary substance of the world, this substance has to contain within itself the cause of motion, the cause of change. That means that it has to have the nature of what, you know, in other philosophies and in mythology and religion would be the place of the soul, right? Because the soul, or the anime in Latin, and the Latin would help you understand, because, you know, anime is what animates, right? And what gives life. So if you don't have a soul, if you don't have anime, if you don't have psyche, you know, this psyche, you will not move. You know, you would be dead matter lying still, and then it will, something with psyche would have to move it. So what they are also adding is that they are making matter entirely alive. So there is no distinction, really, and this is very interesting, between living beings as we see it, and or organic living beings, you know, so things that move by themselves. Apparently, you have trees that grow, you have animals that move, you have, you know, we as part as animals that move. But they would say that even, you know, like things that seem to not move, like stones and rocks and, you know, like things which seem to be inanimate, are actually animate. Why? Because they're constituted by water. They seem to be still at the moment because water has taken that very still form, but it contains the principle of movement within itself, which means that you know, everything is full of this life, this soul. The whole world is alive. So you can think of it as this kind of a, you know, the world is like full of soul. The whole world is ensouled, an ensouled world. Yeah. And this condition is satisfied by water. Yeah. Or any kind of element of moisture, as Aristotle calls it, because it's something that is wet and moist, can also be running and fluid. It might stop for a moment, but it has the capacity in itself to move, and it might move, right? So this arche then, if you think of it in terms of the theologoi, is also something that is both alive and everlasting, right? It is there from the beginning, it will be there till the end, right? It is there throughout, which means that it is alive, everlasting, which means it is athanatos. And we talked about athanatos with the gods. The gods were athanatos, which means that they could not die, right? And anything that is athanatos then takes like the element of the divine, you know? So even though this philosophy is for the most part agnostic by, you know, the earlier traditions, but agnostic as concerns gods, that is, it still has an element of the divine in it, except now the divine becomes water. Water becomes divinity in itself, right? So this divine then suffuses everything, because it is ensouled. And this, if you think of the soul as everlasting and divine and alive, because it's both alive and divine, then it sort of, you know, ensouls everything. And so Aristotle, when he talks about Thales in De Anima, he says, all things for Thales are full of gods. What is this full of gods? It's not full of, like, you know, Zeus and, you know, Artemis and, I don't know, all the different gods, or Demeter. Rather, you know, water itself is a divine element, right? Water itself is something that that takes the place of the divine. So eventually we could say that it's not the choice of water per se that is important out here, right? He could have chosen air, he could have chosen fire, you know, like these two are also things that move, you know, or seem to move constantly. You know, think about fire, it's constantly moving. Air is, you know, something that moves, and other philosophers do choose those. But he's the first, we could say, Thales is the first to attempt to explain variety in nature, this plethora of things we see in nature, you know, and to attempt to explain all the variety of matter, of changes, of alterations as modifications of something that we can find in nature, right? This water is something that you can find in nature, you know, like, you know, I can see this lake outside, and, you know, this is something that you can observe in nature. And this thing, the idea that it is the modifications of this one thing that you can find in nature, which explains the variety of the world, the alterations of the world, the creation, the beginning, the end, the everything of the world, right? So if we want to summarize the achievement of Thales as the first philosopher, the sage, one of the seven Sophoi, you know, this great sort of father of everything, is a kind of not precisely scientific thinking, but the anticipation, let's say, of scientific thinking. So he anticipated, you know, later scientific thinking, and we still have elements of this kind of way of thinking in later thought. A kind of rationalization of myth, you know. So when we think of Hesiod's Theogony and we think of Uranus and Gaia, from which come Kronos, you know, if you try and think of those as in a symbolic way, and say that, you know, in the beginning everything was fused together in Uranus and Gaia, then, you know, the chaos appeared, the chasm, the abyss, the gap appeared, and you know, everything was fused together, let's say, gap appeared, so first came chaos, remember that line from Theogony, and Uranus and Gaia got separated, the sky and the earth separated from this undifferentiated mass by separation division, and from that came time, right? It's with the separation that time came. So we could sort of attribute a kind of, you know, quasi-scientific, quasi-rationalist thinking to Hesiod, but with Thales, we see, you know, no excuses, sort of rationalization of myth, if it is myth at all, right? And another thing that we can sort of credit as, you know, achievement of Thales is one of the very early attempts, and especially the earliest attempt we see in Greek philosophy, for the search of unity in the universal behind the multiplicity of phenomena, right? This kind of this need is philosophical and scientific, as, you know, we would all attest to, but it's also an aesthetic need, you know, this desire for tidiness, this desire for, you know, explaining things in a tidy sort of system. And as you all know, a religious need, you know, and which is why, you know, when we talked in the beginning of philosophy began in wonder, but yes, but also religion, also mythology, you know, these all began in wonder, you know, we wonder about the world and we try to give explanation. So this is also a religious need. So we have a philosophical need to understand things, we have a scientific need to explain things, and we have an aesthetic need to find order and structure rather than get completely confused by the chaos around us, and a religious need, you know, and this is something that that the scientists sort of took in another direction, but it does answer some of the questions which, you know, earlier were posed to myth and religion and narrative and poetry, which now the scientists and philosophers are trying to and attempting to answer in a very different way. So that's the sort of achievement of Thales in summary, and in the next one we will talk about Anaximander. Thank you.